This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon. It is 11 p.m. here on the East Coast, and we're live with new developments tonight in the church massacre in Sutherland Springs, Texas, the worst mass shooting in Texas history. We're learning the Air Force is investigating why records concerning a domestic violence conviction against gunman Devin Patrick Kelly were not entered into a national crime database. The information could have prevented Kelly from purchasing firearms. Authorities also saying tonight that the gunman sustained 3 gunshot wounds, including a self-inflicted shot to the head. Let's begin the latest from Sutherland Springs, Texas now, and senior national correspondent Alex Marquard. Alex, thank you for joining us this evening. You're getting new information tonight about the shooter's past. Tell us about it.
We are, Don. Specifically, one episode in his past that might have prevented him from collecting such a huge arsenal with which to carry out this attack. This dark chapter happening in 2012, back when the attacker was in the Air Force. He was married to a woman who he's no longer married to, since gotten divorced, and he was convicted of 2 counts of domestic assault against both that woman and her son. He was sentenced to a year in the brig, after which he was released, but also demoted and left the Army with bad behavior. We're told that the Air Force did not relay this information to their civilian counterparts. He was not entered into what is known as the National Criminal Information Database. And that if someone is in that database, then when someone goes to buy a weapon, they would normally pop up in an FBI background check. But nothing came up in the background checks. Therefore, we assume that the gunman was able to subsequently buy the weapon and all of that ammunition. We now understand that the Air Force is carrying out an investigation alongside the Pentagon. Don?
Alex, we are learning that one family, the Holcombs, lost 8 family members. You spoke with a surviving family member. How are they holding up?
Yeah, of the 26 dead, you know, almost a third are from this one family. They're not doing so well. As you might imagine, yesterday was the worst day of their lives. They're absolutely devastated, but they are putting a good face on it. We went out to their farm today. I spoke with Scott Holcomb, who lost, among other family members, both of his parents. He said that his parents would want some good to come out of this, that he believes God will make some good from all of this. And he was telling me this as he was crying. He was telling me this through his tears. And as religious as his family was, he wasn't particularly. But he said that after all of this, he is going to start going to church. It is just devastating to think that 8 members, across three generations of a single family, were killed. They included Brian, Scott's father, who was a preacher. He was a substitute preacher on this day. He'd been preaching for several decades. His mother, Carla, who taught Sunday school. His brother, Danny. His sister-in-law, Crystal, who had 5 children and was 2 months pregnant with her 6th. Then there were 4 other grandchildren who were also among the dead. But in the brief amount of time that I spent with them this afternoon, you could tell that they're a very close-knit family, a very tight-knit family, and they will be leaning on each other in the days, weeks, and months to come. Don?
It's so awful. Alex, thank you so much. Our thoughts to the family. Please give him. More breaking news tonight. Senator John McCain, chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, saying his committee will vigorously investigate why the Air Force failed to enter Kelly's conviction in the National Crime Database. Joining me now, Lieutenant Colonel Jeffrey Korn, a former Army attorney, Tom Burney, a former New York City police detective, and Sam Rabati, a retired special agent with the ATF, who was in charge of the Philadelphia office. Thank you all for coming on this evening. Lieutenant Korn, the Air Force is now investigating how it failed to enter the shooter's domestic violence conviction into the federal law enforcement databases. How could something like that fall through the cracks? That's a big question.
Well, I think the question has to begin with what the regulatory guidance is within the Air Force for who reports this information, when they report it, and how they report it. Obviously, we would hope that there is a standard procedure that applies to all Air Force bases. And then the next question becomes, how did this slip through the cracks? I mean, it may be that it was just a unfortunate error that somebody failed to cross all the T's and dot the I's if there was a requirement to report it. It seems difficult to imagine that there is not such a regulatory requirement. Although I'll tell you that all day I've been looking through some of their regulations and I find them a little bit confusing, and I'm not sure there is a clear statement of what offenses need to be reported. And part of that may be because the nature of military offenses in courts don't perfectly translate to the normal kind of felony and misdemeanor type courts that we have in the civilian system.
Interesting. Tom, I want to bring you in. The shooter had served a year in confinement for assaulting his previous wife and stepchild. He was charged with animal cruelty for punching and beating a dog. What is he, and he has gets access to a gun, but what does this tell you about him?
Well, it tells me that he's clearly a troubled individual. My condolences go out to the family and friends that were part of this horrific attack. And yeah, this infuriates me. It infuriates me to no end because we can no longer go apparently to movie theaters. We can't go to a concert. We can't, you know,
church.
We can't have first graders in school. When are we going to sit down and have a serious conversation about addressing a couple things? And, you know, the president earlier today had made a comment about how it's a mental illness problem. And I don't really agree too much with President Trump on a lot of things. But I do agree with him that this is a huge problem because through deinstitutionalization since the 1970s, we have people out there that have mental, you know, issues that are not being addressed. So we have people with mental problems and need psychiatric help. We have still loopholes that in the gun system where people can get access to guns, aside from the a number of illegal guns that are out there. When are we going to have these conversations? And my opinion is that the pain isn't great enough. The pain is not great enough. We haven't lost enough people yet, apparently, because they still don't want to talk about it.
We've lost so many people. When you look at the number of people we've lost just over the last month.
Yeah, right.
And I think that people are becoming desensitized to it.
But Don, when you have 20 first graders who get slaughtered in their classroom.
I don't
And six teachers, wouldn't that be the time to have this conversation?
But there's so many... Every time I've had this discussion and debate on television and off, so many times, it's a circular argument. You want to take their rights away. You're anti-Second Amendment. Why are you focusing on it? I mean,
I'm a Second Amendment guy. I own guns. I believe we all should be able to have
Absolutely.
To protect ourselves and our families. That's not the question here. The question is that there are too many ways that people are able to get access to guns, even legal gun owners.
Yeah.
In the case of Sandy Hook, where this kid, the son, was able to get his hands on, that shouldn't happen. It should be.
We see people, we live in a big city. We see people walking around talking to themselves all the time, right? Imagine if they had access to guns, the kind of damage they could do. We should really think about that.
But,
go ahead, Sam, please.
No, I was just going to say, I couldn't agree more. You know, I heard your opening there, Don, at the beginning of the show, and completely agree. And I can tell you, spending 29 years enforcing the so-called laws on the books, I can tell you, over the course of that career, that myself and so many of my colleagues have tried to get through all the loopholes, the workarounds, as well as the folks falling through the cracks. And despite our best efforts, guns are still going to get into the hands of the wrong types of people, like what happened in this tragedy. And there has to be some kind of middle ground that folks can come together for just some common sense measures that I think we could all agree upon.
So I've got two military men here and a police officer, a law enforcement officer. And if you guys can't get people to pay attention to this, what do we have to get our leaders to do in order to address this issue, at least to address it and to start making some substantive changes? Lieutenant Colonel, anything?
Well, first up, you know, I'd like to say I understand the concern that maybe this individual suffered from some mental issues. But we should also note that there's nothing that we've seen from his military record or the record of his court-martial that indicates he had any mental disturbance. And you would think that if he suffered from some mental disturbance, either he would have been processed for separation from the Air Force for that reason, or it might have come up in his court-martial. Being a sociopath, being somebody who snaps and decides to kill other people, doesn't always mean that you suffer a mental disease or defect. So I think one of the things we have to be careful about is assuming that every one of these incidents can be blamed on that cause. Mm-hmm. The simple reality is this shouldn't have slipped through the cracks. If you look at the federal statute that prohibits felons from owning firearms, there were two sub-provisions of that statute that applied to this case. Mm-hmm. He was charged with an offense that carried with it a penalty of more than 1 year's confinement. Now, the fact that he only got 1 year doesn't mean that that provision didn't apply to him. And he also committed a crime of domestic violence. Both of those were statutory prohibitions to possessing the firearm or for him to have bought the firearm. So if we can't get the system to function effectively when we know that it already prohibits people from getting access to weapons, then the next step of the discussion is already distorted. Yeah. And I'm glad that Senator McCain is going to hold this hearing, and hopefully it will lead to some more effective methodology for the military to input the data when there is a criminal conviction in a court-martial or when right. the service member is separated for mental illness.
Yeah, thank you all. That's going to have to be the last word. I appreciate the conversation. Just ahead, Donald Trump elected to office 1 year ago. CNN has new polling showing the president hitting an all-time low. What it means for his ability to govern and impact on his remaining 3 years. That's next. Many Americans heading to the polls tomorrow to vote on Election Day. It was 1 year ago on Election Day that Donald Trump was elected president of the United States. Joining me now, CNN political analyst April Ryan, White House correspondent for American Urban Radio Networks, CNN contributor Selena Zito, and presidential historian Douglas Brinkley. Wow, it's almost been 1 year. Remember that? Yeah. Selena, tomorrow, Election Day. And I have to read the title of your new piece. It's called America Still Hasn't Recovered from Trump's Shocking Win. You've been talking to a lot of people about this. And so what are you hearing?
So what I did for an article for the New York Post is I brought people, like Democrats and Republicans, together to see how much has healed. And I saw one of the things that has stayed true all year round, and I know I've said this to you before, a lot of people are still stuck on November 8th, mm-hmm. so at midnight. If you voted for him, you're optimistic and excited. If you didn't vote for him, you either are you're still sort of in a state of shock. You think that it's either illegitimate, he didn't really get the popular vote, Russia had something to do with it, but you're still not sort of accepting that this is real. And not much has changed since then. That's what I found, like, I find everywhere.
Yeah.
But those trips to Sterling Heights, Michigan, and Cumberland, Maryland were incredibly striking. One area got a lot of attention by presidential candidates and by, like, ads and sort of bombarded and helped, you know, sway the election. And Cumberland, Maryland, the last president that's been there was Teddy Roosevelt. They were much more, have put it behind them. In Michigan, not so much.
Yeah. Hey, so she said not much has changed, April. The polling numbers have changed somewhat. I mean, he's been in the 30s, you know, since he was elected. But it's going down now. The president got some startling numbers to face in our new poll. And it shows approval at its lowest yet. CNN surveys, that's 36% approve of his performance, down 1 point from October. Disapproval at a new high, 58% disapprove of his performance. How would you characterize the state of his presidency, April?
The state of this president's union is not necessarily as strong as he would like. And, you know, it's sad because when you have a president, you want to see a president succeed. And going back to what Selena said, you know, there are still Americans who are in the fetal position. I remember around 3 o'clock in the morning, I was watching social media and watching the reaction. And still there is such a visceral reaction to what's happening now from those who did not support. There's also buyer's remorse from what I'm seeing. But what I'm hearing, and I travel the country in both Democratic and Republican areas, and what I'm hearing and seeing, many Americans are saying he needs to be off of Twitter. Twitter is one of his biggest downfalls. And he opens holes himself. No one throws him in a hole. He does it himself sometimes. Mm. And he tries to get his way out. And once he doubles down, it makes it worse.
Yeah.
You know, there is buyer's remorse within the Republican Party. We've heard from some senators, from some U.S. senators, Republican U.S. senators. But there are still people who are fearful to say things because they don't want to be tweeted about or have that group, that smaller group, that approve of this president go against them. But we have to remember also, there is a bigger number that disapprove. We keep talking about the approval that is much smaller than those who are disapproving.
58%.
So I'm waiting for that to flip.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm waiting for that to flip.
So
because
Doug,
we continue to hear the approval.
Yeah. Doug, look, take us behind the numbers and why they may be the way they are. Has the president made an effort to reach out to people who didn't support him a year ago? Has he tried to bring the country together?
No, of course Donald Trump hasn't brought the country together, and you could see it by the division everywhere you look. I think, though, Don, there's two stories going on. One is that Donald Trump's not having a good first year. I mean, only 35% of the public thinks he's doing okay. Those are abysmal numbers. I mean, the other only other ones that were bad first years in recent times, I mean, you know, Bill Clinton had like 48%, but that's, you know, 13 or so points different in spread. Trump has been failing. However, in the Republican Party, they're sticking by him. You have 80%, 75% of Republicans. And I think that's where the story is. Will there be more Jeff Flakes? Are there going to be more Republicans backing off from him? And finally, Don, the big problem has been this Russia probe. I mean, he's been like an asterisk president. He's been under investigation almost from day one, and it's hard for people to feel comfortable with him when any moment the you know, campaign manager is getting arrested, and the Mueller report is you know, an investigation is bringing up you know, new ugly news on a regular drumbeat.
Yeah, it's interesting, especially when you talk to when you look at the numbers, Selena, as you said, his base is still with him. Republicans are still with him, 75-80%, even into the 80s, 80 percentile. CNN's polls also has some sobering numbers when it comes to Russia, this Russia investigation. Nearly 64% of Americans say the Russia investigation is a serious matter that should be fully investigated. 32% think it's an attempt to discredit the president. This after the first indictments from special counsel Robert Mueller. The president likes to say that it is a hoax, but I just look at the number, you know, of campaign administration officials with ties to Russia so far. Family members, a cabinet member, a former campaign manager, and others. It is getting harder for his base to call this a witch hunt with so many people with so many ties to Russia, isn't it?
Well, here's the thing that I think that maybe we should be looking at. There's two things that would dislodge Trump voters from him permanently. Two things have to happen. He would either have to become part of the swamp. You know, that's the thing that they don't want him to dab his toe into whatsoever. But also, I think that the Democrats need to start offering some more he's giving you this, I can give you this, and this is better. And I think that's a better message that the Democrats need to work on. Right now, all you're seeing is you're stupid because you voted for Trump, or you're racist because you vote.
I understand, but what does it have to do with the Russia thing? Bring it back to Russia. How does that?
Well, the thing with Russia is, in terms of his voters, that's why I started with the whole swamp thing. That's still not going to dislodge them, because there is a large measure of distrust among these voters for large institutions and for things like these, all things Washington and all things, you know, big government. So they're not going to trust this. I'm not saying they're right. I'm just saying that's their state of mind right now.
They just don't think that the Russian investigation.
Right. And
they still think it's a witch hunt. But my question was, it's getting harder to think that. But you said they still think
that's the only thing I see dislodging him, is if he becomes part of the swamp.
Thank you all. I appreciate it. When we come back, new details on the now infamous Donald Trump Jr. meeting with Russians during the election. The Russian lawyer behind that meeting is speaking out. What she says went down at the meeting and why she wants to talk to Robert Mueller's team. We keep learning more about Donald Trump Jr.'s pre-election meeting with a Russian attorney and her associates. Now the lawyer claims Trump Jr. hinted that if his father won the election, the administration would be willing to review a sanctions law, targeting President Putin's inner circle. Let's discuss now. David Kochaneski is here. He is a Pulitzer Prize winning investigative reporter at Bloomberg News. This is interesting, this interview that the Kremlin Link lawyer, Natalia Veselnitskaya, gave a 2.5-hour interview
to Bloomberg about her meeting with Kushner, Manafort, and Donald Trump Jr. at Trump Tower. She says the president's son, okay, the president's son hinted at changing an anti-Russian law in exchange for dirt on Hillary Clinton. I'm going to make sure I get that. Dirt on Hillary Clinton. How does that affect this probe at all?
Well, I think it certainly stirs the pot. I mean, meeting, when we first found out about it back in July, it was unclear. The Trump administration, others said it was not about, said it was about adoptions. It wasn't about dirt. It wasn't about the campaign. It wasn't about laws. They said it was about the Russian adoption law because Putin in 2012 had forbidden Americans from adopting babies from Russia. But as things have come out, we later found out that the pretext of the meeting was that the Russians said that they had information that could help the Trump campaign, dirt on Hillary Clinton. Yeah. So the administration later had to acknowledge that was true. There are emails that proved it. Natalia's statement now suggests that they were willing to trade. This is a different account than she's given in the past. I think we have to be careful to weigh the evidence as it comes out. Right. But I think if it's true, that's certainly raises questions about how much interaction was there.
Let's talk more about her account, because her account, Natalia Veselnitskaya, her account in the meeting, which included Donald Trump Jr., it included Paul Manafort, and included Jared Kushner as well, different than Trump Jr.'s. She claimed that the president's son indicated if his father won the election, the Magnitsky Act, which was a retaliatory measure the U.S. leveled against Moscow, blacklisting suspected human rights abusers, would be re-examined. And she claims that Donald Trump Jr. said this: looking ahead, if we come to power, we can return to this issue and think what to do about it. Does that sound like, if her account is correct, a quid pro quo to you?
I think it certainly sounds like opening of a quid pro quo. You have to see if anything is going to be delivered, I think. And the Mueller Commission is looking very carefully at this. They've talked to a lot of people in the administration about not only what happened at the meeting, but what their reaction was afterwards. I think that will turn, reveal itself over time. But I think what is interesting is that in this most recent account that she gave to my colleagues in Moscow, that she said that he actually asked for documents to back up.
She asked for documents to prove that money that evaded the U.S. taxes had gone to Clinton's campaign, right?
Correct.
And then she described this 20-minute meeting as a failure.
Correct, right? Because she didn't have them. But I think that, this Magnitsky Act, this had been a thorn in the side of Putin and the Russians. Magnitsky was an accountant in Russia. He claimed that there had been a big corruption scandal, and then he died under mysterious circumstances in prison. So the U.S. Had sanctions that were directed not just at Russia, but at certain oligarchs who are close to Putin, and that it was very painful to his inner circle. Yeah. So this, is a huge point of contention, and Putin wanted to do whatever he could do to turn it back. The other interesting thing is that when the talking points that she brought to the meeting, the New York Times revealed just last week that this is the same thing that she had mentioned to a high-ranking Russian government official. So while there's been some question as to was she a private lawyer, how closely connected she was with the Russian government, she had given those exact same talking points to the equivalent of the Russian Attorney General.
Interesting interview, and thanks for coming on and talking
about
it.
Thanks for having me.
David Kuchineski, appreciate it. When we come back, two President Bushes with one united criticism of President Trump. There are questions about his fitness for office and how Trump is responding. Well, it sounds like there is no love lost between the current Republican president, Donald Trump, and his two Republican predecessors, George H.W. Bush, who calls him a blowhard, and George W. Bush, who says Trump doesn't know what it means to be president. That's according to a new book by my next guest. It's a presidential historian, Mark Updegrove. He is the author of The Last Republicans, Inside the Extraordinary Relationship Between George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush. Also, Mark McKinnon joins me. He is a former advisor to George W. Bush and executive producer of Showtime's The Circus. This is going to be a great conversation. I can't wait to talk to you guys. I cannot wait. I do want to read this book, so thank you for bringing me a copy of it. So you sat down with Presidents George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush last year. This was during the heat of the 2016 campaign, and they talked about Donald Trump. Strongest words, this is from the 41st president, George H.W. Bush, when he said this: I don't like him, I don't know much about him, but I know he's a blowhard. I'm not too excited about him being a leader. Set the scene for us. Tell us more about why he chose to make those comments.
Well, it was in May of 2016. It was at a time when Donald Trump was going to be the presumptive nominee of the Republican Party, and he was being very frank about his views about Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. And it's understandable, Don, if you know the Bush ethos. It's antithetical to everything that Donald Trump stands for in many respects.
Yeah.
The Bushes are emblems of civility and of decency and of humility and the notion of putting service above self.
And of conservatism and very classy people, regardless of what you think about them, you know, ideologically. You know, they set a standard in many ways. What about George W. Bush? He had some very critical words for Trump. What did he say?
He talked about the fact that when Trump said, "I am my own advisor, I rely on myself more or less for all the advice of my of affairs," Bush said, "You know, there's something wrong about this because humility is the hallmark of great leadership, and this guy must not realize what it is to be president." And so he was a little less direct. A little less blunt than George H.W. Bush, but I think he was pretty obvious in his criticism for Donald Trump.
Mark McKinnon, let me bring you in. Both President Bushes have appeared to be somewhat reluctant to speak out or critique President Trump, but we're starting to see some cracks here. This is George W. Bush. This is back in October. Watch this.
"Our identity as a nation, unlike many other nations, is not determined by geography or ethnicity, by soil or blood. This means that people of every race, religion, ethnicity can be fully and equally American. It means that bigotry or white supremacy in any form is blasphemy against the American creed."
And the former president here is showing us how another president may have responded to the violence in Charlottesville. Mark McKinnon, you worked for George W. Bush. How big of a deal is it for him to speak out about a sitting president?
Well, I think it says a lot that he spoke out. You know, no matter how you felt about George W. Bush as president, it's almost unanimous that people think he's been a great ex-president, and partially because he's kept a very low profile and stayed off the radar screen. But the fact that he came and spoke out in that speech as strongly as he did testifies, I think, to how strongly he feels. He also said bigotry seems emboldened today, and the public discourse is degraded by casual cruelty. Mm-hmm. You know, and just echoing what Mark said, that really is the Bush ethos, and that was part of what he ran on in 2000. In fact, a lot of what but the main focus, the main message of the Bush campaign in 2000 was that he was running to restore dignity and honor to the White House because he felt that it had been degraded by President Clinton. Both Bushes revere the institution of the White House, and that's what they can't stand is to see that institution degraded.
Mark Updegrove, let me ask you, did you get any sense that the motivation behind these comments could have come from, you know, Trump's attacks on Jeb Bush during the campaign?
I don't think so, Don. I think the Bushes are pragmatists as it relates to politics.
Jamie Gangel says the same thing. She doesn't think that it's motivated by that.
They know that there are sharp elbows during a campaign.
Right.
But I want to, if I may, add to what Mark said. I think that George W. Bush's speech here in New York City was a clear shot over the bow at Trump, although it was indirect. I think, though, there was a more there was another statement that was a clear reflection of their views of Donald Trump, and that was the joint tweet that both George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush made after Charlottesville, in which they condemned bigotry and anti-Semitism at a time when Donald Trump did not, when there was ambiguity from Donald Trump in terms of what happened in Charlottesville. So that was a pretty clear statement, again, a shot over the bow at Donald Trump.
Mark McKinnon, the White House responded to the Bush's comments and in the process attacked the legacy of both Bush presidents. And it's really quite telling. Here's what the White House, this is the official statement, this is what they told CNN. They said, "If one presidential candidate can disassemble a political party, it speaks volumes about how strong a legacy its past two presidents really had. And that begins with the Iraq War, one of the greatest foreign policy mistakes in American history. President Trump remains focused on keeping his promises to the American people by bringing back jobs, promoting an America First foreign policy, and standing up for the forgotten men and women of our great country." So that said, the president himself has not gone on the attack. Do you think that this statement is a good illustration of the differences between the Bushes and President Trump?
Well, I do think, although it's not directly from the president himself, I think it's a classic counterpunch. And, you know, listen, that they took a shot at him. They took a shot back. I think that's fair in politics. And it's a fair observation they make. I mean, it is a different Republican Party now. There's no question about that. A lot of people that supported George W. Bush supported him because of his message about compassionate conservatism. And I think for a lot of Republicans today, they're missing the compassionate component of the conservatism that they see today in the Trump administration.
Mark McKinnon, I have to go, but before I do go, I want to ask you about your colleague, your former colleague on the circus, Mark Halperin. He's been accused of multiple women of sexual harassment, in some cases sexual assault. He's lost his position at NBC, at Showtime, among other jobs. What's your reaction to his reported behavior?
Well, it's inexcusable and it's indefensible. You know, we never saw a sign of any of that kind of behavior during the first two seasons of The Circus. Nevertheless, it's been determined that if the show goes forward, that any role for Mark Halperin being involved in the show would be untenable.
Yeah. Critics will say, well, you had to have known something. You had to have seen something. You worked with him for a long time. What do you say to them?
Well, I just say that, as I said, during two full seasons of The Circus, during which I spent a ton of time with Mark, and as soon as I heard this, I also called the production side of the show to ask if anybody else had seen anything, any hint of this kind of behavior, and nobody had, and I didn't as well.
Mark McKinnon, Mark Updegrove, thank you so much. I appreciate both of you joining us this evening. When we come back, are liberals too quick to cry racism when it comes to the GOP? Are Democrats too quick to call their Republican opponents bigots? That's the focus of a new piece by CNN political commentator Peter Beinart in The Atlantic called Republican is Not a Synonym for Racist. He joins me now, along with CNN political commentator Scott Jennings, Tara Setmeyer, former communications director for Republican Representative Dana Rohrabacher. This is going to be very interesting. So your column, Peter, welcome everyone, by the way. Your column in The Atlantic asks the question, is American conservatism inherently bigoted? Tell me how conservatives and liberals view bigotry differently.
I think conservatives tend to view bigotry as a kind of conscious act aimed at keeping a certain group down. I think liberals are more likely to view bigotry as the effects. If your policies have the effects of perpetuating a kind of second-class citizenship for certain people, then that's bigotry. The point I was trying to make in the piece is that one of the really alarming things about our politics today is that I think the Republican Party is becoming increasingly overtly racist and bigoted, and I think both liberals and conservatives have to figure out how to try to define a conservative politics. Conservatives are never going to agree with liberals on a whole bunch of things, right? But to try to bring the Republican Party back a little bit to where it was in the 1990s or under George W. Bush, when racial hostility was not as much an animating force in American politics.
So your conclusion to this question is American conservatives inherently bigoted, you say?
Well, I think unless Republicans are willing to take on voter ID laws that courts have shown specifically aimed at making it harder for African Americans and other people of color to vote, they're going to be vulnerable to this charge.
Scott, what do you say? The column goes on to say that conservatives are fearful of discussing politics because they dread being called a bigot. Do you feel that way?
Well, I think Peter's column is interesting, and I agreed with many of the points he made in it. I do think that people overstate or read too much into some of the preferences that Republicans have on voter ID laws. I know a lot of Democrats as well that think you should have an ID in order to vote. And I also know a lot of Republicans who think we should make it easier for people to get IDs so they can vote. And I think that Democrats have used that issue over the years to try to draw a line between Republican policies and racism because they don't want African Americans to vote. That's not true for the people I know. I think that Republicans actually want to talk to all voters about how our policies can make their lives better, and that includes African Americans. In fact, Republican politicians I know would love for the party to do better among African American voters than we do now. I certainly feel that way. I thought Peter's piece was really thought-provoking, and I hope people in leadership in both parties read it because it raised a lot of interesting points.
Tara's so ready to get in. Tara, go ahead. She's about to come across the desk. What?
Well, no, I think that there is some validity to what Peter is saying. But the problem is, and as much as I respect my fellow Republican Scott Jennings in hoping that our Republican lawmakers would want to get back to the conservatism that I grew up on, and I'm sure Scott did too, it's very difficult to do that now when we have ceded the high ground, the moral high ground, to what Donald Trump has injected into the political discourse. And a lot of this bigotry and some of these some of the effects of that, the tribalism that now has really on both sides, but more on our side, just because of the way Donald Trump ran his campaign, the way he's reacted to things like Charlottesville, those kinds of issues have made it very difficult to have these conversations seriously, because how people just point to, well, Trump is the leader of your party now, so how could you possibly say that you want to do things that don't, you know, that don't seem bigoted? It's difficult, because conservatism is not about that. Conservatism is about individual freedom and the ability to have people, empower people, to make their own decisions and live their own lives without the state coming in and taking over. I mean, for the most part, in the simplistic way, it's a worldview. Unfortunately, yeah, there have been a lot of people that have come in and perverted what that is and turned it into something where actually not.
You can't say it's a worldview now when people want to build walls, when people, you can't say it's a worldview.
Well,
because even now it's like globalism is like a big buzzword.
Of conservatism, of, you know, if we go back to Burke and Milton Friedman and you know, Bill Buckley and like the thought leaders of conservatism, it is a worldview, that those principles remain, but the people who are now representing this are the ones that are fallible.
But here's, okay, so I understand
perverted
what you're saying,
it.
But how can you say that something is not bigoted if you don't, you know, if you, for voter ID laws, yeah, if you try to restrict the rights of African Americans to vote, if you gerrymander districts in order to be able to do that, to win elections, if you don't stand up for the rights for all people, if you speak the way that, just look at the party platform on gay rights and on.
Democrats gerrymandered.
Right. But no, that's why I think that would be the single most important thing. I think conservatives feel, there's a lot of studies that conservatives feel that liberals often use the term bigoted in a kind of promiscuous way to kind of shut down conversation. And I think that I give some examples in the piece where I think that actually is true.
Yep.
But I think that if conservatives want to be less stigmatized, right, first of all, Donald Trump makes it much harder.
Really
but
difficult.
Even before Donald Trump, I mean, we have cases in courts in North Carolina and Wisconsin which have shown that Republican legislators specifically targeted African Americans to try to reduce their voter turnout. And I think in that climate, conservatives are always going to be vulnerable to the claim. If, given the history of the United States, if you're trying to make it harder for African Americans to vote, you're going to have a lot of difficulty in overcoming this label of being
okay. Let me see, because I can hear people saying, I could just hear the crowd now saying, well, isn't that politics? Because, you know, African Americans tend to vote Democrat or what have you. But in order to be not bigoted, Scott, instead of restricting African Americans from voting, I think it's, as you say, then you need to appeal in ways to African Americans so that they want to go out and vote for you, where you don't have to restrict them from voting, correct?
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think the Republican Party needs to do a better job of campaigning among African American voters, Hispanic voters, you know, non-white voters, because for a party to thrive and grow, you have to be able to win votes among all parts of the population. This voter ID issue, I think, is really interesting, because there's a way to solve it. And I've seen some estimates about what it would cost to do this. I acknowledge there is a group of people in this country, a lot of African-American voters and other minority and poor voters, that would have trouble finding an identification. And I've seen some information about what it would cost to give everybody an ID by the federal government. And frankly, I think it's well worth the cost if it means that we get satisfaction among Republicans that we do have secure elections.
And I believe
so
Rhode Island.
I am not opposed at all to the concept of getting people IDs,
yeah,
and making sure the government pays for that, if that could satisfy both sides of this debate.
I believe Rhode Island tried this, yeah, and it worked, where you have the voter ID issue, but then you had, for people who couldn't afford it, they subsidized it and made sure that people got those IDs, and I think that solves that problem.
Well, it's interesting. I remember having, this was a while ago, the conversation with Barbara Walters, who didn't have a driver's license. So to have an identification with a picture on it would be a work ID, and Social Security card doesn't have that. So it's not, you know, people, not everyone has identification, just so you know.
Yeah,
but she's a woman of means, but even, a lot of poor people don't drive and they don't have identification.
Well, that's why I think to Scott's point, then you figure out a way to do that. If you need an ID, a photo ID to buy medicine or get on an airplane or take a bus, then you should be able to do that to vote.
Thank you all. When we come back, the president just touching down in South Korea just a little over an hour ago. Right now, meeting with American and South Korean troops. We're live in both North and South Korea.